to consulting with lots of big industry types on their internal kind of security processes and protocols, is very prolific. He's written 8 bestseller books on things everywhere from Java security to security of online gaming. He's published, or he's authored over 100 peer-reviewed articles. He is an editor of a monthly security column, and my favorite is he produces a podcast on computer security called The Silver Bullet, which he gets to talk to the who's who's of computer security, and those are always really fun to listen to. Let's see, we are really lucky that Gary comes back to Indiana University a lot because he's an alumnus here. He got his PhD in cognitive science and computer science, I won't say how many years ago.
A million.
A long time ago. And he's currently serving on the Dean's Advisory Council for the School of Informatics and Computing. So we're really lucky that every few years we twist his arm a little bit, not too hard, and he agrees to give a talk on the latest and greatest in computer security. And I think the last time you were here a couple years ago to talk about your new book, Exploiting Online Games, is
probably,
that right?
Probably, yeah.
Last time. This time, I'm really excited because he is going to talk about U.S. policy and what perhaps we should be doing differently when it comes to cybersecurity efforts. So
there's a policy. Who knew? There's a Canadian in the house.
So join me in welcoming Gary McGraw.
Thank you. Thanks, Kay. I always wonder who it is that I gets introduced for these talks, because it doesn't sound like me. So this is work that I did jointly with a guy named Nate Fick. And among other things, Nate is the latest Silver Bullet security podcast victim. So if you want to hear what Nate has to say for himself, you can listen to that. It just went up yesterday. But Nate is an interesting guy, because Nate is a real warfighter. He is a Marine, was a Marine, and he was involved both in Afghanistan and Iraq, and served 3 tours of duty and led a platoon of 89 guys, brought them all back alive, which was a heck of an accomplishment. And Nate understands what war means. So when it came time to talk about cyber war, it seemed like it would be smart to get somebody who knows what war is, because this term cyber war gets thrown around by people in computer science as if they know what war actually means, and they don't. And the policymakers are very confused about all this because, you know, you have confusions about, oh, I don't know, denial of service being an act of war and silly things like that. And so we wanted to try to get across to some policy people in Washington. And remember, some of these people don't even believe in evolution. We wanted to get across to these people the seriousness and importance of this topic in a way that they would understand. So, you know, that's where this talk originated, and we wrote it down in a paper. I'll give you the URL for in a minute. Kay mentioned that I work for this company called Cigital, so I'll tell you a little bit about my background. I am a geek. I have a PhD in computer science from here, and I've been doing software security for about as long as I've had a real career out of school. It's a field that we help to invent. And at Cigital, we have about 300 people, and that's what we do all day. So what that means is helping usually large financial institutions or gigantic software houses figure out how not to build a broken thing. You know, the issue is, in computer security, for many years the paradigm was, let's protect the broken stuff from the bad people by putting a thing. Everybody know what that thing is called? Firewall. That doesn't work. You know, so the simple idea about 20 years ago is we come along and we go, I got a simple question. How come this stuff is broken? And really, nobody'd asked that simple question before. So we're trying to teach people who build code and design systems how to do it right. And that's my perspective. Now, I'm a completely commercial security guy, computer security guy. We don't do much business with the federal government. About 8% of our revenue comes from federal government. Although in my early career, I was sponsored by DARPA to do some research on static analysis, and it became commercialized over a decade and is now available through HP. So, you know, we're trying to intersect these worlds of policy, of deep geekdom, of the military, and say something clever about cyber war, and that's where this talk came from. Here's the basic outline. You know, the first problem is, what the heck does cyber mean? I hate people who use the term cyber, and I got lambasted on Twitter last week because somebody said, you use cyber 30 times in your abstract. And I'm like, well, you know, I was trying to appeal to the Washington people who use cyber, I don't know, cyber all the time in front of everything. So we got to define what cyber whatever means. Then we got to talk about the offense problem and what real defense is, and then the defensive solution. So that's the basic outline of the talk today. Here's the URL to the paper. The paper is called Separating the Threat from the Hype: What Washington Needs to Know About Cybersecurity. This was written when Nate used to be the CEO of the Center for New American Security. That's a think tank in Washington. Nate is now the CEO, interestingly enough, of a company called Endgame. You may have heard of Endgame, or maybe not, but Endgame got a reputation as the, quote, black water of cybersecurity, which is really disturbing. So when Nate took that job, I was like, my God, we wrote all this stuff about cyber peace and doing it right, and then he joined these Blackwater guys? What's going on? And it turned out that, you know, Nate was Nate, and he's turned that company completely around, taking an offensive capability and turning it into something that can be used for defense. So more about that later. But that's who I did this work with. Right, so number one, how much of this stuff is hype and how much of it's chimera? You know, policymakers don't really understand how computers work, and you can see that even when it comes to content protection, where, you know, the Hollywood people tend to treat computers as if they're just really fancy VCRs, which of course they are, but they're also a whole bunch of other stuff too, right? So we have people who are trying to set policy, and policy lags everything else by probably 20 years, if you think about it. So let's talk about adoption curves of technology in the world. Maybe 120 years to adopt electricity to 90%. You know, penetration worldwide. I think the telephone was a little faster. That was about 60 years to adopt to 90%. Now, those curves kind of go like this, right? The adoption curve is slow, and it goes over about a century or so. If you look at the adoption curve of the internet or of smartphones, mobile phones, they're almost straight up. So we haven't had time as a society to let this sink in and figure out what to do about these issues. It's just so darn fast that even the technology people, like those of us that do tech for a living, we're like, gosh, we're lost too. It's just moving incredibly fast. So it's not too much of a surprise that the policymakers are way, 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 way behind. But it's our duty as citizens and technology people to go and try to speak their language to them and get them to understand this stuff. So number one is helping the policymakers figure this out. Now, when you throw around cyber whatever in cybersecurity, we have three things that are just deeply tangled up. Number one is cybercrime. Number two is cyber espionage. And number three is cyber war. And they often get conflated, and it's often very convenient to conflate them. Because if you can get people all up in arms about how pervasive cyber whatever crime is, and you go, oh, that's just like cyber war, then you can beat the war drums and get the war machine, you know, cranking along. It's kind of a pretty obvious tactic, but it works very well because, you know, there's a lot of cyber crime. Now, nobody's sure exactly how much. There's one study that says it's $1 trillion per year. That seems unlikely, but even if we divide by 100, it's still a ton, right? And you hear about things on the news, like the big Target hack recently, or Michaels, or whoever. I guess, has Indiana University suffered from one of those? Yes? Yeah? Oh, good. As an alumni, I'm glad about that. Right? So cybercrime happens. Now, it doesn't end the world, does it? It's not like we all had to stop buying stuff and go back to the Stone Age. So far, that hasn't happened. But we do have to deal with cybercrime. And it is much more pervasive than even cyber espionage. Now, it used to be easy to say cyber espionage is not all that pervasive, and then Snowden happened, right? So, you know, it turns out it's more pervasive than we thought. But I got to tell you something about Snowden, guys. Here's the deal. Our spies are supposed to spy for us. So when they do that to the Norwegians, I'm cool with that. And I was in Norway saying this just 2 weeks ago. You know, you guys spy on us, we spy on you, we kick your spies' butt. That's right. Right? So that's totally fine. I'm not anti-espionage. But I am pro-freedom, and I'm pro-democracy, and I think there are problems when we have people that are set to spy on us, that set to spy on our adversaries or foreigners like the Canadians, and then they spy on us instead. And you know, there's sneaky little tricks that they've used, like bouncing all the telephone traffic off of Canada for a millisecond so that it's foreign source and all sorts of other things. That's bad. It's clear that we do have to rein in the NSA. And in fact, part of what I'm going to talk about today is a policy change that I think is absolutely fundamentally necessary, but I'm going to get to that in a minute. Right, so cyber espionage, we heard about all the New York Times hack, you know, we heard about the Google stuff, we heard about all the Snowden documents. Clearly, cyber espionage happens. But it happens a lot more than war. So what is cyber war, and what makes it any different from crime and espionage? Well, what we tried to do when I was working with Nate was to try to separate out the hypey stuff that's not really cyber war from what real cyber war is. And we used a very clear red line of kinetic, right? So if something blows something up or ruins something from a physical perspective, it's like, you know, sending a bomb in and ruining something. That it was our line for cyber war, and that works as pretty well as a definition. It isn't perfect, but you know, we went back and read our von Clausewitz and all this stuff, and that's what we came up with for that thing. So there are some things that get thrown around all the time in Washington. Like, you've probably heard about the Estonia DDoS attack. Has everybody kind of heard about that? I'm getting a few nods, right? So imagine Estonia. How do you think their connection to the net is going in Estonia? Right? They're connected to the net through a straw. So filling up the straw, on one of the series of tubes, by the way, with too much information is rather easy to do. And in fact, the attack that took Estonia off the net, oh my God, a nation state went down. I don't even think Google would have noticed. Or they would have noticed. They would have been like, oh, look, a little tiny ant tickling my pinky foot. You know, try to just squish it. So Amazon wouldn't go down. Google wouldn't go down. They would notice, but they would easily handle that level of attack. That is not an act of war. That's just a DDoS attack. And you know, there are a couple of things that are even worse, like China hijacking the internet, which just turned out to be a BGP fail. And BGP is so badly designed that, you know, it's easy to, oops, I transferred the entire zone to some lady in Iowa. Damn, let me undo that, right? So there was somebody just a couple months ago who got all the great firewall traffic just for a little short while, and she was in Iowa, so I don't know what she did with it, right? So you know, and then this blackout thing that was just complete hocus pocus. There's a bunch of baloney. The most pervasive baloney, however, is the DDoS attack. So you still, when you go and talk cyber war with policymakers, you know, like Congress people or senators, they always bring that up without fail. So we have to figure out how to get them to not bring that up. Now, are there examples of real cyber war? Sure. You know, we blew up a Soviet gas pipeline in the 80s. This was used to be classified, but it isn't anymore. And basically, the Soviets were borrowing some technology from the Canadians, and we all knew it. And so we were like, well, let's make that technology not work quite right. You know, so we sent them some stuff that they stole, and they installed it, and then they turned it on, and then they blew their pipeline up. You could see it from space, something like a 100-kiloton explosion. It's unbelievable, right? So that counts. In 2007, the Syrians were building a nuclear reactor. They were having the North Koreans do it, and the Israelis just kind of swooped in and blew the bejesus out of the thing. Of course, the Syrians said, we didn't have a thing there, so everything worked out just fine. But, you know, you didn't have a thing? Well, we didn't blow anything up, so everything's fine. We're all cool. So. You know, the Syrians had a real air defense system at the time. It was a Russian-built one, but they had one of those at the time. And it just didn't function while the F-16s were flying in to bomb. So that's an example of use of a cyber capability in a cyber war. You turn off the air defense system and then fly in and do something kinetic. Russia did attack Georgia before they took over Crimea. right? They went and attacked a piece of Georgia, and they used tanks and people, and they had a cyber attack simultaneously. So they were going after the Georgian command and control system. They were going after the banking system, and the whole internet was all clogged up. And that was in concert with a kinetic attack. So I think that counts as cyber war. There's this one, you know, the USB drive infection thing, you might not have heard about. That happened in Iraq number 2. And it was a big enough deal that a guy named Bill Lynn wrote a story. He was the Assistant Secretary of Defense at the time, I think. Wrote a story for Foreign Affairs. And it was the first time where somebody with a uniform that was way high up in the Pentagon said, all right, we have a real risk. Let me tell you a story about something that happened to our command and control system. Now, there wasn't anything kinetic there, but this made the Pentagon kind of sit up and take notice. And then the last thing is Stuxnet. So you probably heard about Stuxnet, which was our way of slowing the Iranian nuclear program down. And I got to tell you, I'm in favor of slowing the Iranian nuclear program down as much as we possibly can. But Stuxnet, though it was a cyber attack, was not really a piece of cyber war necessarily. And we need to talk about two things about Stuxnet. Number one is what it was really like, what that attack looked like, and how sophisticated it really was, how hard it would be to do something like that as an offensive capability. And number two, what were we really trying to accomplish with Stuxnet? And it turns out what we were trying to accomplish was make the Iranian engineers feel like they were incompetent boobs, which we did, right? Until they figured out that we were doing it. They just thought they couldn't do this with 70s tech. They thought they just couldn't get this stuff right. So more on that in a minute. I do want to get back to this stitch, though. So we have these spy guys, and General Alexander, who's getting ready to retire, I don't know if it is this week or something. He might have retired yesterday, or I think it was April, the very end of March. So there's a new guy that's going to head up the NSA. He's from the Office of Naval Intelligence. The old guy, General Alexander, who I've met a few times, is a patriot. He's a smart man. He's a careful thinker. But he has a problem. And the problem is this. We told General Alexander, please spy on all of our enemies and do bad things to the people and don't tell us about them, but, you know, to the bad people, right? Because we're worried about our security, and that's your job as a spy. Oh, and by the way, could you also defend all the stuff, too? He has two jobs. Now, if you're a spy and everybody's carrying around one of these in their pocket, which is an insecure disaster, by the way, whether it's Android or iOS doesn't really matter, right? This is just it's like a personal beeper device. It tells you whoever cares where you are, who you're talking to, how long you talk, probably what you said, who you sent email to, what websites you visit. It's all like here in this one spot. Talk about an awesome spy tool. You're like, if I own Angela Merkel's phone, then we can find out what the Germans are up to. And guess what? That's what we did, right? So then you say to the same guy, please spy using all your possible capabilities. And, oh yeah, could you make those cell phones more secure? Now, which job do you suppose is more fun? But which job do you think takes priority? That's the calculus that we ask these guys, like General Alexander, to make on our behalf. And, of course, they're completely conflicted about this. You know, these aren't power-hungry tyrant people. These are our people making an impossible decision. The only way to make that decision is to split those two capabilities into two separate things and set up policy so that we have a Chinese wall, so to speak, between, you know, the offense and the defense. When have we done that before? Well, after World War II, when we had developed a nuclear capability in this country, there were some very smart people who said, listen, this is a power that humankind, whoa, it's a lot of power. We cannot have this power in the hands of 1,000 people or less. You know, so we can't just have people who can build and deploy nuclear weapons and there's only 1,000 of them because they could turn against us all and own everything. That would suck, you know. So what are we going to do? Well, let's try to split this into the people who build nuclear weapons. We'll call those the Department of Energy guys. And the people who deploy nuclear weapons, and we'll call that the Department of Defense. And they're separate. They got separate leadership. They got separate objectives. That is a Chinese wall. Then, that was very brilliant. That was a damn good move. And that move still persists to this day in the way our government is set up from a policy perspective when it comes to nuclear weapons. We have got to do the same thing for cyber. We have got to do it. Because right now, we're asking the people that do offensive stuff to also make their offensive stuff stop working so that we're all more secure. And in fact, it's gotten so bad that according to the Snowden documents, the NSA paid, you know, a company to intentionally screw up a piece of crypto that was fundamental to everything. The ability to generate random numbers turns out to be essential for cryptography, and to do it in an unguessable fashion. And the NSA paid RSA company $10 million to get that wrong, to put the wrong default in there. Screwing up security for everybody, by the way, us too. Now that was when, you know, offense is overreaching. We got to like snap that back and we got to get things back to normal, which I think we can do, but we have to go further and stop asking people that are working for us to do two things that are at cross purposes at the same time. They just can't do that. All right, so you've gotten a little bit of a hint about what I mean when I say offense and defense. Offense is about exploiting vulnerabilities. It's about finding out why cell phones are broken and then using them as listening devices. Or it's about vacuuming up all the metadata in the world, which, by the way, is surveillance. So we have a surveillance state. And then being able to look at that surveillance and tell when the bad people are talking amongst themselves or driving in the same car or whatever, right? So that's what offense is about. It's about exploiting weaknesses in systems so that you can carry out your job of espionage and maybe also, you know, subtly screwing stuff up. Defense, on the other hand, is not about just monitoring systems in real time. There's a lot of confusion about this, mostly due to Hollywood. You know, they also make us think that satellites only look straight down, which is ridiculous because we live on a sphere, right? So, so Hollywood makes us think these silly things, and one of the silly things that Hollywood makes us think is that defense must be some guy sitting at a command center with all sorts of maps of the internet going, oh, there goes an attack. Better stop that. You know, that's not how it works. Computers are way faster than people. And people aren't going to notice an attack, and you can't just watch. I mean, there's this stupid video that Kaspersky put up last night about cyber attacks happening on the globe, and they have all these little lines crisscrossing. It makes great eye candy, but it's just complete bullshit, right? So we got to get our policy people to understand that's not what happens when you attack a computer. You're done. Like, done. You're done. And if you need a tool to attack a computer, you just use this thing called Google, and you Google one up, and then you aim it over there and press return. That's how you do it, right? So defense cannot be about monitoring. It can't be about watching the network and putting up firewalls and cardboard shield defense. It has to be about building stuff that's harder to attack. And I don't mean impossible. It would be great. We have the theory to build stuff that is theoretically impossible to attack, but engineering-wise, we're never going to do it. So, you know, all we got to do is make stuff better than it is now. And believe me, guys, it's easy to make stuff better than it is now, because most of the stuff that we built, we just built it to barely work. We weren't trying to build it to be secure too, right? So we got it to work, and we're like, damn, it works. Ship it. You know, and when you think, well, let's make it not work. All you got to do is just change one little thing and it just collapses like a house of cards, which is, sorry about that, us tech people have been building those for a while. So if we want to do real defense, we have to do security engineering, and security engineering is a challenge. Here's a deal in computer security. It's fun to talk about exploits and hacking and hacker boys and people with metal in their hair, you know, face and all that stuff. That's really fun. Hacking is fun. That's why there's NASCAR, right? NASCAR is fun to watch. You see somebody crash, they die, you put their number on your truck, you make a new saint. I'm from Tennessee, so I can say that. I grew up really close to Bristol. You know, so that's kind of fun. But how many Volvo car safety channels are there, guys? Zippo zilch. So it's not so fun to teach about how to architect things properly, how to test things properly, what it means to design things properly, getting rid of all the bugs and design flaws. That's just not as fun. So we suffer from, humanity suffers from the NASCAR effect. And that's just the way it is. But we have to get over that and do some engineering too. There's more to offense that's problematic, though. And I want to talk about the problems. Here's the main problem. Having a good offense is not the same as a defense. And if you think about the calculus of mutually assured destruction, which came from the nuclear age that we live in, you might accidentally think that having a good offense is a great defense. Like, if you do that to me, I'll just nuke you into oblivion, right? That's a threat that we can credibly make, sort of a scary threat, but it's a threat that we can credibly make. And mutually assured destruction was a useful calculus for dealing with the Soviet Union until we spin them into the ground, right? So don't forget that part about spinning them into the ground. That's going to come back later. So here's the deal with offense now. There's no such thing as an ultimately destructive weapon in cyber offense. Nobody's going to win a cyber-first launch. There's no winning that. In fact, there's no way in hell you could take out somebody's capability and be assured that that country was just gone cyber-wise. That's not possible. So we're asking people, you know, to build, you can think about these as offensive rocks, right? So we're building rocks, and our guys are the fastest, most accurate rock-throwing dudes on the planet, which is great. They work for us. But we live in a glass house. And you know what Grandma said? Don't throw rocks when you live in a glass house. Well, in Washington, they're like, we're going to make more rocks. We're going to get zero-day rocks. Our rocks are great. You know, and you're like, dudes, we live in a glass house. Maybe we should work on that. Seriously, maybe we should work on that. Does that seem simple-minded? It's not simple-minded enough for congresspeople. But that's what we need to get across right there, right? So companies like CrowdStrike are problematic. They use double-speak terms like active defense to cover up offense. That is bad. Active defense is a bad idea. It's this notion that we're going to allow corporations to defend themselves arbitrarily against attack, and they don't even maybe know who's attacking them, but by God, they're going to fight back. It's like the Wild West. Everybody gets a gun, and you shoot people, and you're just like, well, I killed him before he killed me. You know, it made for good TV, I guess, for a while. But it didn't scale, and that's not how we do it. The biggest problem with active defense is this. It's called the attribution problem. This is a screenshot from The Hobbit. So everybody know The Hobbit in here? The Hobbit, I painstakingly built this example in this paper that I wrote. And I actually went back and read The Hobbit and thought about this particular scene, which I'm going to tell you about. And then you know that movie came out? They changed the damn scene. It's like... It was like, oh, man, I can't even, oh, so much for that paper, right? So the idea is, you know, Bilbo was supposed to be a burglar, and there were some trolls nearby, and the dwarf said, hey, go steal some stuff from the trolls because you're the burglar, and he's like, oh, whatever. And he got caught immediately and put in a bag, and then all of the dwarves got caught and put in a bag, and then, you know, the trolls are arguing over how to cook one of these and whether it's even worth cooking or you should just eat it raw, you know, like how, and sort of amusing, but Gandalf didn't get caught. That's the wizard guy. And the wizard guy was throwing his voice and making this argument between the trolls and got them in such a big argument that the sun came up and they all turned to stone. That's the whole story. Now, what's that got to do with attribution? Well, the trolls didn't know that it was Gandalf that was throwing his voice. They thought it was their buddy or their enemy or their brother or whatever, the other troll that they wanted to fight. Right, so if you're in a war, it's very helpful to have your enemies fighting amongst themselves. It's way better for your enemies to fight each other than for you to fight either one of them, it turns out. So if you were going to have a cyber instantaneous response, you damn well better know who is attacking you, really. Imagine that we thought North Korea was attacking us through their big pile of servers. No, through their always-on electricity. No, through their useless missiles. No, I can't think of a way they could do that. But imagine that they were attacking us. You know, and the Chinese made it seem like it was the Iranians or whatever, you know. So we attack back on the wrong people. Here's the whole point. We have not solved the attribution problem on the internet. You know that New Yorker cartoon on the internet, nobody knows you're a dog? It's still true. If you go to the academics and you say, hey, have we solved the attribution problem? The answer is no. We cannot, with perfect, you know, accuracy, say that guy did that. We use human intelligence, and you know, we use all the Snowden Facebook who's he what's it, and we can sort of boil it down. But that's easy to spoof, guys, and it's really easy to make it appear that somebody else is doing the thing that you're doing on the internet. So if we have active defense on a hair trigger, wrong people are going to get attacked for the wrong reason, and it may lead to a real kinetic war. That sucks. That's just dumb. Now, I gave this talk most recently at the Office of Naval Intelligence. That was an interesting time. I'm not a military guy, you know, although I did work with Nate on this. And I walk in with the CO. I was about 30 seconds late because it took 20 minutes to get through security. And I got to park, like, right. It was cool. It's pretty cool way back in the deep dungeons. So I walk in with the CO and 400 people go, whoop, and it was just like, whoa, this is a little odd. But it turns out that those people agree that this problem hasn't been solved. They understand that. And it turns out that even if you look at the Snowden documentation, and I know this because I talked to Bruce Schneier in Paris, who's looked at all of the Snowden documentation, that the attribution problem has not been solved. Even in super double black cool classified land, nobody solved that problem. And if that problem's not been solved, then we cannot have active defense unless we're just stupid. Right? That's one problem with offense. Problem two with offense. It turns out that attacking systems is easier than you thought. Let's have an example. Well, you know, we talked about Stuxnet a little. Now remember, Stuxnet was not supposed to break Iranian centrifuges. It turns out they had a whole warehouse full of more, because centrifuges, they're just not that sophisticated. They're using 70s technology, you know, little kind of springy-like things that twirl around, and uranium hexafluoride gas is just dumb the way they're doing it. But that's the way we did it in the 70s, right? So that's what they're doing. And, you know, they set all this stuff up. It's pretty easy to build new centrifuges. So if you break some, they just replace it with a new one. We weren't trying to do that. What we were trying to do was make the engineers that were building those systems feel like they couldn't do it, like they were not capable of doing it. They would set everything up, it would look right on the computer, then they would press go, and then, you know, it would seem to work, and then they'd get the wrong stuff out. They got the wrong grade of uranium, all sorts of weird, it just didn't work. And while this wasn't working, the Ayatollahs were saying, if you don't get this to work, we're going to kill you and your kid. And the Israelis were blowing the other half up with sticky bombs. Seriously. Talk about a shitty job. Like, you're an Iranian nuclear engineer, your government wants to kill you, they're threatening your family, the Israelis blew up your friend, and you can't get this freaking computer to do the right thing. That was the situation, all right? So we didn't want to, like, go ruin centrifuges. We just wanted to make these people feel like they couldn't do it and break them. Just break them. You know what? I'm totally fine with that. Breaking nuclear engineers of the enemy is fine with me, right? So how did we do that? Well, let's go to online games. Kay mentioned that I wrote this book on online games. There's this game called World of Warcraft. Anybody heard of that game? Right, so World of Warcraft has this little loop, and there's a loop that, you know, renders the world on the screen every once in a while, like 1,000 times a second. And we can just put a little patch called the detour patch. Thank you for Microsoft Research for providing detours in previous operating systems. And we take control of the program, and we put it over here, and we run our own program, subprogram called a DLL that we've injected. So we just take control of the program for a while, and then we give control back to the original program, and nobody's the wiser, right? We just had some cycles, we did some stuff, we did some game cheats. This was great in like 2004 or so. This worked really great against World of Warcraft. Guess what, guys? That is the heart of the attack against the Siemens system. The Symetic Step 7, you know, the PLC was just a DLL interpositioning attack. Guess what? That doesn't work against online games anymore. Online games defend themselves against that attack. But it works great against Siemens control systems because those were built in the 80s. Right? So that's kind of an interesting thing. So was it all that sophisticated, the payload? No, the delivery mechanism was kind of sophisticated. And the hiding mechanism was kind of sophisticated because we didn't want them to know we were screwing around with their control system. We were going to be kind of like a rootkit. Wanted to just do it and have nobody be the wiser. But the attack itself was nigh on trivial. You want to see what works against online games now? This is what works. Instead of having a software breakpoint, we have a multi-processing computer. Anybody got one of those? Just a little joke. Everybody's got one of those. Even your phone is one of those. So, you know, you turn off the processor that's running the piece of code you're interested in screwing with, and guess what else it's running? It's also running all the security mechanisms, by the way. So it just goes and stops, and you take control, and you do some stuff I'm not going to talk about, and you build a little exploit over on another processor or in another thread. Don't worry about the technical arcana. And we inject it into the brain of the first processor that we stopped. So it wakes up, and guess what we don't have on processors? We don't have a Rip Van Winkleometer, right? The processor doesn't go, whoa, a million cycles went by in the last second. The processor just goes, I was asleep and now I'm awake. Let me do some stuff, you know, with a new brain. That still works great against online games. And that is not what Stuxnet had to do. That is not what Stuxnet had to do. All it had to do is interpositioning of DLLs, 2007 tech. So you see, are we susceptible to those attacks? You're damn right we are. 2007 attacks work great against our control systems and our critical infrastructure today. That is a bad thing, guys. So we shouldn't be figuring out how to attack these systems because it's just too easy to do. So that's number two. And by the way, there are just a few vulnerabilities. There's a little map for you. See, it's growing linearly. There are a lot of open vulnerabilities. We already talked about this, you know. The disguise idea in Stuxnet was the atypical part. But it's really easy just to screw up a process. If you just want something to, you know, break, like a power plant to not work for a while, you can just fuzz at it. You know, non-deterministic hacky crap will take that down. So the people that get in the news for hacking a control system or SCADA system yawn. This is kind of what they're doing. It's way more interesting when you get up to process control. We're not just trying to disrupt the process. We're trying to screw it up in a certain way. That's way more interesting. That takes some understanding of how the thing works. Stuxnet was there. And then disguising your steps, that's even more. So, you know, you can see the capability line does, in fact, go up. But everybody can do this. Even teenagers can do this, which is what most hacker boys are. Right? So don't forget that. That's another problem. Here's an economic problem. Right? How many countries in the world can afford to have a nuclear sub fleet? Just guess. 3,000? How many countries are there anyway? Anybody know? Not that many. Not that many. 270-ish. Yeah. So two can afford to have a nuclear sub fleet. And ours is way better anyway. Right? So you can't just go out and like build one of those. You can't, like, Pakistan can't go, by God, we are going to do nuclear. That's not going to happen. Right? So that's not going to happen. Stealth fighter fleet. How many states can do that? Oh, you know, we're talking about 10 or so. You know, the Eurojet fighter fleet, that's even more because that's a factor of four smaller. So we're getting to a lot more countries, but not that many more. And these guys are building stuff to refight World War II. Which, now that the Ukraine thing is happening, doesn't look like such a bad idea. After all, I used to get a big laugh line on this slide, but it's not so. Maybe Leopard 2 tanks will come in handy. Who knows? Right? So, and then we got the billion-dollar cyber weapons program that goes against hardened military targets that are, you know, these are cyber targets that are hardened. How many states have military budget in excess of $1 billion? Take a guess. 70. Not all of them, but 70. That's a lot. And then we talk about a cyber weapons program that goes against stuff like, I don't know, power plants and hydroelectric dams and critical infrastructure stuff. That's about $100 million proposition. And then you're talking about a whole lot of nation states, but it gets worse. Here's where it gets worse. If you want to just go up against some piece of critical infrastructure and take it down and cause trouble and terrorize the population, that might cost you $5 million. Damn, I know people who have that much money, you know? And if they want to develop like a targeted attack against infrastructure, they could do that? These people are kind of jerks, you know? That's not good. So you can see that economically we have a problem too, because it turns out to be easier than we thought to develop this capability. Oh, I already covered this, the NASCAR effect. Right, so several reasons why offense is problematic. Glass house, capabilities not as much as we thought to cause a real attack. The economics are not on our side for an offensive solution. So what are we going to do for defense? Well, number one thing is that, you know, we can't protect the broken stuff from the bad people these days. If you guys have to leave, it's okay. So if you have to get up and leave, go ahead. Some people had to do that. So this thing here, this was a great, great defensive mechanism in 1325. Now, what was the state of the art of attacking stuff in 1325? Well, you put metal on your body, like so much you can barely walk around, and then you get a pointy stick, and you like point your pointy stick at the other guy who has metal on his body, and you know, the enemy's like 8 miles away, so you put some metal on your horse, and then you get on your horse, and you're like this big hunk of metal with a pointy thing, and you ride all the way the 8 miles to the guy's castle, and then you go, oh, damn, water. Because getting to the castle with your metal-covered body wasn't very easy in 1350 or whatever, so that was great defense for that. But you know what? You want to take one of those things out today? What do? You paint it from space with a satellite, with a laser, and then you just shoot a predator drone at it or whatever. It turns out that the moat doesn't go all the way around the castle. And water doesn't really matter anyway. So this notion of a perimeter defense, which worked great in the 1300s, doesn't work at all now. You know why? You cannot defend a perimeter if you don't have a perimeter. So can you draw the line around the system that you use today? Nope. There's no edge anymore. We can't say, well, this is the us part, and that's the them part, and we're going to put the thing in between. We'll call it the moat or the firewall, you know, because everybody's got these phones. Everybody's got, it's like not bring your own device, but why didn't you bring your own device to work? You know, it really, seriously, that's what it is now. Things have changed. There's no perimeter. We're building massively distributed systems on purpose. And you know what the cloud is? A whole bunch of new software that's a massively distributed system. Fantastic. Try putting an edge around that. So this paradigm of, you know, old school perimeter security is not going to work out too well. It works out kind of like this. You know, this is what happens when a gate goes bad. See how effective that gate was on that road? Super effective. So what are we going to do? Well, we actually have to engineer things properly. We have to think about software security, which is my own field. I'm giving a talk at 4 about that in the Monroe County Library for Real Geeks. If you want to go geek out, we're going to have a geek talk. Or, you know, the notion of building security in. And you can have too much security. There's such a thing as too much, especially from a security mechanism perspective. So we have some issues in security engineering, like how much is enough and how much is too much and how much testing should we do and when should we stop? And we deal with this every day at Cigital. We have to figure out, well, how much do they really want to spend to secure that thing? Oh, really, only that? Okay. All right, so that's an issue. Here's a quote where Panetta was really wrong about attribution, right? So because we have not solved the attribution problem, we just don't know where it's coming from or who to attack or how to defend ourselves against who. The who problem is the problem. So there's a lot of information out there about how to build security in. And I'm not going to spend very much time on this, but this is the heart of what I've been living for the last 20 years. And we're actually making some progress in the field of computer security. In fact, if you look at software security as a subset of the revenue of computer security worldwide is probably about a $20 to $40 billion thing now. Software security is 10% of that. So we're talking about $2 to $4 billion just for software security, revenue-wise, on the planet. The interesting thing is computer security is growing at about 8.9%, and software security is growing at 20%. So now we're like the pinky finger of computer security, but pretty soon we're going to be these two fingers and then maybe this one, and I'm not going to do it. Right? So we do, in fact, know what to do. Come on, too much pizza? Right? So these are some of the things that we can do. Like, if you have code, you can review it. If you have an architecture, you can do some threat modeling and some architecture risk analysis. If you're done with your thing, you can do some penetration testing. This is all stuff that's explained in a series of technical books, including the one that I wrote. And then there's this thing called the BSIM Project, which is a community of like-minded commercial entities that are working on software security together. We all get together and we go, well, gosh, I thought you were a bank. Well, you know, Morgan Stanley, how come you have 15,000 developers? And they go, well, because banks are software houses now. Oh, I see. Well, does anybody want the stuff that you have? Yeah, the money? Yep, they want that. Well, how do you store that? It's just a series of bits. Oh, really? Cool. That makes you a heck of a target. Those guys worried about computer security? Damn right they are. And software security is the way that they're approaching that. They're trying to build their systems to be less susceptible to attack, not just to protect their broken systems from attack. And we've been studying that and measuring these companies. We're up to about 75 companies in this study. Here's some logos for you. My favorite logo is Intel is part of the study, but I'm not allowed to use their logo, so I gave them a new one in Times New Roman. What do you think? Should I send them a bill for that one? And we have, you know, all sorts of huge banks. We have all sorts of gigantic software companies. We're working on this together. Now, we might all be collectively doing it wrong together, which is what we were discussing at the Runcible Spoon this morning. It's quite possible that we're all a bunch of lemmings running off the cliff. But if so, we're spending $4 billion to do the wrong thing. Quite possible. I hope not, but quite possible. I don't think so myself. Here's the deal, guys. If you use software today, and you're not just some crunchy open source Linux hippie dude, you use software that the BSIM touched. And let's talk about some numbers. I'm going to skip the next two slides and just get straight to numbers. The next three slides. Here are some numbers from the BSIM project. When we started out, we started with 9 companies. The last version had 67. We're talking about 250,000 developers. So that's not kid stuff. It's a 250,000 people who write code all day. We're fixing their stuff. Now, 3,000 people, the software security group members plus the satellite added together is about 3,000, are controlling the work of this 250,000 guys. How many developers do you suppose there are on planet Earth? Anybody? Just guess. We're not going to get out of this talk if you don't guess. 20 million, off by one order of magnitude. 5 million, pretty close. It's probably 8 million. That's an estimate. You know, I've done my homework and I've looked all around. It seems like about 8 million. So, in the BSIM project, we are 1/29th of the way there. Woohoo! Because until we teach everybody that's building our systems and building our modern stuff how to do it right, we're just going to be making the problem bigger and bigger and bigger. You know the real problem with the BSIM? The government is not doing it. If you go to the government contractors, even the defense contractors, they do not do this stuff, which is utterly ridiculous. You know, we'd love to measure the government, but there's nothing to measure. We'd love to say, well, you're not tall enough to ride the ride, but they're not even at the ride. So that's a problem. That's something that the policymakers can do there too. One last point, and then we'll be done. I'm all good with deterrence for war. I don't want to see a cyber war. I'm not a peace muffin. I don't think that we should get rid of the military. I have a lot of respect for the people that serve our country in the military, and I'm glad they do it. Thank goodness they do. But we should try to avoid war if we can. Here is a clever way to do it. Instead of working on mutually assured destruction and offense-only solutions to the cyber problem, maybe we could outspend our adversaries on defense. Maybe we could build systems better and do it so much better in this country that everybody else is behind us when it comes to defense, to building stuff right. And you know what? As the number one economy in the world, limping along though it is, we actually have the luxury to do that. We just have to decide to do it. Right now, we really are at risk. You hear the stories are all scary. There's a lot of FUD. There's a lot of baloney. You know how I feel about that now. But we do have risks that are systemic, and we have got to work through those. If we figure out how to use security engineering as a deterrent, that'll help in all sorts of ways, you know, because we have to do cyber defense anyway. First strike's not going to work, and this would be a hell of a differentiator that we can actually do in the United States. Right, so here's some policy points for the policy guys. None of these really matter for you guys. Just keep it in mind about the conflict of interest that we've put our cyber warriors in today. They can't be offense guys and defend our systems at the same time because we're just asking them to work at cross purposes. We have to fix that. Guess what, everybody? This is a democracy. It is your responsibility, if the Snowden stuff pisses you off, to say something about it. And it's your responsibility to ask your representatives to do the right thing when it comes to cyber policy. Because we're a democracy. And if we don't do it, nobody's going to do it, and we'll get exactly what we deserve. So please, get involved and, you know, think about these issues. If your opinion differs, that's great. That's what a democracy is about. But at least we need to talk about these things and work on this issue from a grown-up perspective instead of talking about little hacker boy, who's he, what's it stuff. All right, some pointers. I write a column for Search Security. The last column just went up 2 days ago. It's about why firewalls and fairy dust and forensics don't actually work. And that is our current approach to computer security. We have a blog with a cool name. There's this silver bullet thing. The latest victim of silver bullet is Nate Fick. The one before that was Charlie Miller, the guy who's been hacking cars, by the way. So they're all fun conversations. We did one with Kay, what was that, a trillion years ago? Back when you were doing security, right? And there's this book. Kay said she'd buy everyone in this room a copy of this book. So yeah, if you're in Kay's class, just ask for your... Oh, I said the Kay said, but that's okay. Kay might as well have said. If everybody in this room buys a copy of this book, I'll get like $30, so get right on it. That'll cover my tab at the rail for one night, right? So, right? That's it. Thank you very much for coming. Let's do one question, maybe two, so quick. Anybody? Yep.
We also suck at metrics.
Yep.
We're getting better at metrics.
The BSIM project that I sort of elided and went through very fast is a measurement project for security. The problem with computer security is we can't put something in a box and measure whether it is secure or not. So we have to retreat to second order measurements, and that's, you know, unsatisfying, but that's what we have to do. So that's what the BSIM does. Check out the BSIM at bsim.com, bsimm.com. Totally free, under the Creative Commons. All the data is published. Use it. That's a measurement stick. Great question. Who's next? Good question, but an easy one. Yep. One more.
What about XP going away and Microsoft not covering anything anymore? What's that going to do? I keep hearing about all the machines that operate.
Who cares? You know what? So the banks are going to have to like build new ATM machines. They better damn well get on it. Yep. It's about time. There is no excuse for using old, broken systems with known attacks anymore. In fact, the new systems are cheaper, and they're better, and they, you know, everything's better about them. So XP should die. Kill it. Now we're officially done. Thanks again.